Hello, my name is Matthias Grawinkel and I'm working at the University of Mainz. I had the pleasure to work together with the guys from the ECMWF to actually dig through their data, dig through the logs and create this work. So the ECMWF is short for European Center for Medium Range Weather Forecasts. It's a weather prediction center based in Reading in the UK. They provide global weather forecasts for up to 15 days and seasonal forecasts for up to 12 months. They've been there since 1975 or something and working and doing a very great job since then. They host multiple supercomputers. So in the November list, they had the places 28, 29, 82, and 83. Basically, they are buying always two machines of the same size, one for production, one for research, and because they have to have a high availability in there. Right now, the machines 82 and 83 do not work anymore because they have been decommissioned. In total, they had about 100 petabytes of total storage capacity spread over multiple disks and tapes and HPC storage systems. What I will be telling you about is there are two in-house developed storage systems, namely ECFS and MARS. What they face, and this is quite interesting, is they have a compound annual growth rate about 50% and even a little bit more of that. So they face a really a constant growth and they somehow have to manage that. So the motivation behind this work for me was I wanted to understand how archives and especially active archives are working. So archives where you have a huge amount of data where every bit may be read at any point in time. So not just store the data and keep them cold, but everything may be active at any time. So to build these systems and think about them, you have to first understand the content and the behavior of such systems and what are the current problems that I as a researcher would like to solve and what are the future challenges, except from 50% growth rate. So the problem there is that only very few studies are actually existing out there. And especially even less traces exist to build and design such systems. But we actually require those to evaluate and do our research. So with this work, I add another study to this field, and especially to my best knowledge, it's the first study of a large-scale active archive in the terms that I just described to you. So I will present you an in-depth analysis of the two mentioned systems, ECF and MARS. And I will give you a characterization of the content and the usage of those systems, an analysis of the caching behavior that they have, a study of the tape backend because they are doing a lot with tape, and I will release most of the scripts that you will see here and all the data that built up this, basically whatever you can see here you can reproduce for yourselves. A short introduction about their systems. So ECFS is a general purpose user accessible archive system. This is well known. We have seen also from previous studies that these systems are out there a lot. But MARS is something new on the horizon. So it's an object database for meteorological data, and it's considered to be the world's largest archive of numerical weather prediction data. So the system basically works in the following way. Every file that is in both of the systems eventually is stored on tape. So tape is the primary target for all files, but until they get there, they are first stored on several disk caches and finally get to the tape. They, for some important files, they also have a secondary tape backup on an offset backup site. So the traces that I will now show you where and what we were. Do you see the pointer? Okay, you see the pointer, that's good. So we have a lot of data, and the order here is also the order that I will tell you about what I saw. First, we have an HPSS system in the back end, and I have a database snapshot of all contents, what is in there. So when were the files created, used, and modified, for example. Then for this ECFS, I have all the information of every single file that went in and went out and how the files moved. For the MARS, I have a good overview of how many bits and bytes went in, how the queries looked like, and what got out. And I also have, over 2 years period, I guess the log files are even more, but I concentrated on just 2 years of data. about every single cartridge movement, so I can exactly tell which cartridge went from which drive to which other drive, which is quite interesting. The set, all the data is was extracted, sanitized, obfuscated, and will be released now. So some data about the archival system, which is called ECFS. Basically, you have some client tools, and you always operate on full data or on full files, like with put, get, delete, and rename requests. In total, it's close to 15 petabytes of data. Back then, in September 2014, 137 million files spread over 5.5 million directories. They just use 0.3 petabytes of disk cache, which is a ratio of 1 to 43. Historically, they decided to categorize the data into file sizes and spread them to different, define different caching strategies for the file sizes. Especially the tiny files are completely held, always held on disk drives. But again, every single file sooner or later appears on the tape. So content characterization. This is built on the database snapshot from the last year, September. We saw that just 26% of all the files that have been written have actually been read again from the tape. So just keep that in mind. We have obfuscated everything except for the last, everything behind the last dot, so we know the file extensions. We have some unknown data which do not have an extension, but besides that, we see a lot of packed and domain-specific files, like netcdf or these grip files, which are weather domain-specific. So you could guess they educated the users well, because in the end they packed a lot, which is a good sign. So from the data size, you can see here they peak between 8 and 16 megabyte, but basically everything is included here. So characterization of the workload. So as I said, I saw everything that went out in and out. So we have about 38 million put requests that made up a total of close to 12 petabyte of data, and just 38 million get requests. So the system is clearly write dominant, with a factor of two something about that. We saw get requests on just 9% of the full file corpus. So we have clearly some very, very hot files in there and a lot of cold data. In the end, we have a cache hit ratio. So cache hit ratio is when the disk drives kick in, of 86% of all the requests, especially as all the small files are always cached on disk. And byte-wise, we have seen something like 45% of all the bytes came from disk drives. Down here, these are just the the hottest 3% of the files. This is just a zoomed picture here, where you can see things like 30% of all the GET requests, especially for the tiny files here. These are the tiny files. You see something like 30% of all the requests fall to just 2% of the files. Which again shows there are a very small fraction of files that are very interesting, very hot, and a lot large cold tail. We've analyzed user sessions, where a user session is a user on a single host machine which executes multiple commands in close succession. So after the last command, when there is within, 60 seconds, another command, this would all include one session. So we identified a total of 1,190 different users, also including users like root or other cron job-based users that are counted in here. And they provided 2.7 million sessions in total. What's interesting here is I marked the fifth percentile, the mean, and the 99th percentile. What you can see here is that it's actually a very broad spread, so you could not tell this is a typical session, but basically everything is in there, from a single command up to 10 hours of running and multiple thousand commands. Especially, we have seen 1.1 million sessions that included read requests. And here from some bytes, basically a big backup or something. So everything was included here. What we found was very interesting are we see a lot of re-get requests. This means within a session, a file is retrieved, and within the session, the exact same file is retrieved another time. So this is something that we also saw in previous studies from other archival sites. So this seems to be a thing. Why exactly? I am not exactly sure right now, so this could be further researched. We asked ourselves what would be the impact of adding more or less cache to the system. So to answer this, we used the ECFS access traces and developed a simulation environment to actually answer this question. We implemented a most recently used a FIFO random strategy, last recently used an adaptive replacement cache, which also keeps track of both the frequently and the recently used files. And we implemented a BLADY cache, which actually has to look in the future just to have a near to optimal baseline. We also see what the ECMWF was doing during the time frame. So we replayed the traces with a 12-month warm-up phase, and after that we measured the following 17 months. So what you can see here is with different cache sizes, which were growing, you can see here the cache hit ratio, and this is for the medium files from 1 to 8 megabytes. The interesting thing is that this is actually the order of their efficiency. So the most recently used is actually has to be considered very harmful because it is this line down here. The FIFO does also not work very well. Random is not a bad strategy if you do not want to think about anything. LRU is clearly better. ARC seems to make a very good job here. The BLADY cache is up here, which is quite good. But the interesting thing is this upline, this line up here. This is what the ECMWF actually did during the time frame. So this leads to the assumption that they somehow do a really great job. The question is why, and the assumption is that they actually have a huge warm-up phase because basically they have more than the 12 months. For other file sizes, this looks a little bit different, but for the medium file size, it's very interesting at this point. Okay, this was the ECFS. Now let's come to the bigger system, which is called Mars. Mars has a dedicated query language. You can tell something like, get me the temperature, then the humidity for Santa Clara from some date till some other date with a 5-minute resolution. This is just the only thing that I could think of, but the researchers there actually have huge and very more interesting queries that they do. Mars then assembles results files, so basically it grabs a lot of fields that they found, assembled in a results file and puts it on a supercomputer for further usage then. The system stores a total of 170 billion fields that are assembled into just 9.7 million files. The system is growing a lot, so every day about 200 million new fields are added that stem from sensor data or from a model output. In September, they stored 39 petabyte of data and used about 800 gigabyte of metadata to handle these mappings from fields into the files. They used some sort of a three-tiered caching architecture. So they have, if a query comes, it first asks the field database, which is resided on the HPC storage system. If it's not there, it goes over to the Mars servers, which also have some sort of 1 petabyte of disk cache. And if it's not there, the tape is required. They use some manual optimizations like 250 terabytes of reserved space where they can actually cache fields or files when they know that they will be hot, for example. So the characterization, again, less like for the ECFS, we see that just 23% of the files ever stored to the tapes were read again, which is quite interesting. And here you can see the file sizes are way bigger. So peaking at 128 to 256 megabytes. So basically it's a little bit shifted, but there's a lot of more content there. What's interesting is the workload characterization. So we see how the traffic looks like. This is a daily throughput in terabytes. So actually it peaks somewhere here with about 120 terabytes of data coming in, just getting out, and about 40 terabytes of data coming in each day. What's interesting is in 2013 they got the new computers. So this is a symptom that they see every time they get new computers, they have this spike in the storage capacity, the required capacity, and the required throughput is growing with each new generation of machines a lot. Over the total observed time frame, I have some numbers because obviously I like a lot of numbers. There have been 150 million archival requests that put in 36 petabytes of data. What's interesting is the factor of 10 towards the read request. So the system is heavily read centric with 1.2 billion retrieve requests in total. From these requests, about 2.2% also involved at least one tape, which is it shows that they have a very good disk cache, but nevertheless, 2.2% of all the requests required one tape. What's also interesting is that you have 13.3 billion read requests, so read fields from the tape drives. So which would mean a tape drive is put in, it has to be winded to the particular position and then read. So actually there were obviously 13.3 billion wind and read requests involved. So they have a lot of tape, obviously. At the time I did this evaluation, they had three big libraries running, and we distinguished between loading and mounting tapes. So when the cartridge comes from the library and is put into a drive, we call this a load, and when the drive actually mounts the system and makes it usable, we call it a mount. So we investigated the years 2012 and 2013 and tracked everything that we could. We saw a total of 32,000 different tape identifiers, which does not mean they were all active at the time, but they were replaced, others were decommissioned, but in the end we saw 32,000 different identifiers, about 230 different drives. In total there were 9.6 million tape loads, really where a robot put a tape and put it somewhere, which is about 9 loads per minute. So basically the systems are running all the time. You can see that tape was actually actively used. What is interesting here is how often tapes are used and are there hot tapes, and obviously there are some very hot tapes. So again here we have the median, the mean, and the 99th percentile, which you can see here that 1% of these tapes actually were used more than 3,000 times. Here you can see a CDF for both systems, where if you make the cut here, there are some very frequently used tapes that could be considered as keep them in the drives and do not move them away because they are obviously used a lot. What's also interesting is here that this is the same graph but normalized. So both systems, ECFS and MARS, both show quite similar tape frequencies. I also had a look at the tape mount latencies, which is the time from a tape load request until the time was actually in the drive and could be used. So the median here is 35 seconds, but the mean is actually growing a lot, and the 99th percentile is actually sort of a problem, because if you have to wait more than 4 minutes, and this is just 1% of all the requests had to wait more than 4 minutes until the drive was actually available. This is, for the MAST system, the amount of tape loads and tape mounts. This line here presents the tape loads on a monthly basis, I guess. It's a monthly basis. And this one is the tape volume mounts. This means there are obviously sometimes you get a tape remount. So it's in the cartridge and it gets mounted again without moving the drive. But what's the problem is, we saw that 14.8% of all tapes were actually loaded from another drive less than 60 seconds ago. So it was took out and put into another drive within 60 seconds. So there was a lot of movement that had not to be there in the end. So the question was, can we improve this somehow? Because we have some goals like We would like to minimize the number of drives because they are expensive and they break. We would like to reduce the mean time to mount because we would like to get the data faster. We would like to reduce the tape mounts because tapes wear actually out. And we would like to maximize the reuse. So as long as the tape is in there, we would like to use that as much as possible. So we analyzed the drive utilization, and this showed some sort of exploitable idling times where cartridges are in the drives, but they were not used, actually, so they were not mounted. So this led us to the idea of can there be some sort of opportunistic preloading. So we did a correlation analysis of all the tape movements and saw that there is some potential that could be exploited. There would be a lot more loads involved, but we could place tapes that they could be used in advance. On the other hand, we saw these 60 seconds tape reloading, which leads to the assumption, why not let the cartridges longer in the drives? And there is a lot of potential where we could do some further research to see if this would help somehow. So let me conclude this talk. So the ECMWF is in operation since a long time, and obviously they are doing a great job with a very interesting system. They actually have a lot of hands-on experience, which becomes visible at many points in their system. Especially for the workloads that they see, some of them are very predictable, like the production workloads, because these are models that are executed and calculated every day, and they know exactly in advance what will happen. So they can do some manual optimizations, like preload this whole tape content, for example, because they know what's happening. On the other hand, they have researchers running, and these workloads tend to be somewhat chaotic, because they, of course, explore the data that is available, which in the worst case requires a lot of data that needs to be assembled. As a conclusion for the ECFS, it is just another archive. We saw previous work that described very similar systems of a very similar size, which with similar accesses. So this is fine to add another study because more studies are always good. But the MARS opens actually some sort of another category because, to the best of my knowledge, there is no such other system described in the literature. But we also see that tape and disk drives can be used to build such a system, but as long as you do some sort of batch processing and you're not constrained to immediate feedback, because we saw these mounting times, and especially if you have a request that involves a lot of files and a lot of tapes, these things, the requests tend to stack up. So basically, if you do the wrong request, you can wait hours or even days until the data is assembled and gets out. This heavy use of tapes also have some interesting drawbacks, like they have a very high wear out on both the tapes and the drives. And these unpredictable stacking latency I just mentioned, this is a problem, and MARS also has a system that sees that such a request would require too many files, and some requests are just plain not possible because they would take a week, for example, to assemble the data. So as a conclusion, as we find some potential to, so this would be my next steps in this direction, to have a closer look at what we could get out of these tapes, because obviously there is some potential to reduce and improve the whole system and reduce the wear out and get faster access times. So this is the end of my talk. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope you learned something out of this many data. I learned a lot. This was a very interesting experience. And at this point, again, thank you, ECMWF, for allowing me to browse your data. This was very interesting for me. I hope this collaboration could be extended somehow. So if you're interested in the scripts and the traces, they will be available at this GitHub account. And by the way, if you're interested in working with us or with our research group, we are looking for new PhD students and postdocs. So thank you. If there are any questions, please. guess there is a question.
There are microphones, there are two of them, one on each aisle. So if you have a question, please step up so that everyone can hear your question. Thank you.
Hello. Okay, so my name is Umesh. I'm from Nimble Storage. I'm wondering if all of the data could be stored on disk, and you know, thereby you avoid all of the mechanical loading and unloading. One petabyte of disk would cost about $50,000 today. Later on, you know, we could imagine all of the data being stored on flash. Even. So, what are your thoughts on that?
Sorry, I was not exactly sure if I understood you correctly. You mean, could you just ditch all the tape and go for full disk? Or
yes.
Mm-hmm. I guess yes, but you also have to consider the costs here to have all the disks on and running all the time. And I think this is somewhere between a historically grown system and the actual price point that you have, because for these amounts of data, tape may be still even cheaper than building up a new, complete new disk system.
Okay. Even if you account for the complexities and the handling, you think it's still cheaper compared to disk?
Maybe not. I don't know. This is something. Maybe the ECMWF guys can answer this question. Maybe some vendors may answer this question, what they think, how much such a system would cost, and if it would run. So I'm maybe not the right guy to answer the question.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Hi, I'm David Rosenthal from Stanford. I'm interested in the wear out issue. LTOs have a 260 full file pass limit, I think. Are you tracking this and replacing the tapes that are used frequently and so on? Because it seems like you're going to be burning through tapes and drives a lot.
So, for two answers to this question. First, I just had a look at the log files. From the log files, sometimes tapes disappear. There is something, but it did not quantize this. But if you have any questions, my colleague Leonard Source, who is the co-author of the paper, sitting up there. So if you have any concrete questions about this, just ask him. He is very happy to answer all your detailed questions. So I just know the logs.
Thank you.
Brent Welch at Google. So I think related to the disk question, I agree you probably can't afford to buy replace all tapes with disks, but with your data you could simulate, okay, how many more disks do I need to buy to, you know, to store the top 10, 20, 30% of activity, and also those hot tapes, I wouldn't park them in a drive because that blocks active, I wouldn't park them in the tape drive, but I would just copy them onto a disk and be done with it. So you should be able to simulate the benefit of doing that with your data.
Exactly. The problem here is for the ECFS, I have exact movements. I know exactly which files were active, and this goes into this cache simulation. So I have a huge chapter in the paper which exactly looks at how much does more the ratio of cache efficiency and the capacity of the caches. For the Mars workloads, I actually do not know which files or which fields have been retrieved. This is one of the drawbacks there. I just know how much went in and how to characterize the system, but I cannot tell what exactly was hot.
Do you know but it sounded like you knew about hot tapes, right? Individual tape volumes were hot?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so those you could just copy on a disk and declare victory, right?
Would be possible maybe with the logs. Yeah, this could also be a next step from log files. Thank you for that.
Your last question, if it can be quick, that would be appreciated.
Yeah, John Kajak with Seagate. I was wondering, does the data reflected in the paper actually consider migration? Does ECMFWF do any sort of tape migration from older formats to new formats? If so, does the data reflect part of that migration process or not?
This is a good question. I'm not exactly sure. As again, you see the tapes appear and disappear, and somehow things are copied, but I cannot. Maybe you could also track this copy. maybe it's in there. Have a look. Sorry.
Thank you.